item once again. Apologies have been received from Councillors Rosblad and Roy Land Rosgrove's David Matty, John McKinsey, Steve Mumby, Andy Spoil, Andrew Mason, Sharon Ross, and John Kushner.
And I presume the additional names that were mentioned previously would be.
Well, Mayor, it's probably just to mention that John Matthew Thomas is in hospital and not very well at all. And also Dave and Massey, they're not releasing, so we can send the best wishes to the council to vote for the meeting.
No, that will be done. Thank you very much, Mayor Anderson. I've got a very pleasant thing to do at this time, and that is to advise members of Mayor Anderson's 60th birthday, which is today. It's hard to think that he's only 4 years younger than I am. My congratulations to you, Joe, and many happy returns.
I'm more than happy to be spending it here.
On a more serious note, can I draw members' attention to the recent death of Councillor Jeremy Wolfson's mum, and on behalf of the council, extend to him and his and family its sincere condolences at this sad time. And also the recent death of Councillor Lily Hennigan's dad, and on behalf of the council, I extend to her and her family its sincere condolences at this sad time. That's my personal condolences to both. Thank you very much.
If I could just once again remind members, you are only required to have meetings any disclosable pecuniary or prejudicial interests, in which case the member will need to leave the chamber during consideration of the item. Are there any such declarations?
None, we move straight on. Are the minutes of the extraordinary City Council and the City Council meetings which you should have before you held on the 15th of November 2017 agreed? Councillor Crowe.
Lord Mayor, on page 9 of the minutes is the record of the, or page 8 is the Mayor's announcements. I note that there is no details of any of the questions that were asked of the Mayor by opposition group leaders. The details of the Mayor's announcements were in there. The details were put in paper by Councillor Radford in there, but the questions that were asked of the Mayor by opposition councillors were not included. So can I just move that in future minutes the details of any questions are included and the answers?
You can move that if it's got a second, then. It's got a second, and I can put that move. I can put that vote right to the meeting. Councillor Crowe moving that questions and answers be noted. Can I just say it's not normal in minutes for that to happen. Minutes normally describe very plainly just what has happened in the meeting and don't go into that kind of detail. But for the sake of democracy, we'll put it to the vote of the council. Can I see all those in favour of that? Can I see all those against? I think there's a lot more than six there, so we'll just say it's overwhelmingly, that's just an overwhelmingly rejected. I'm going to sign the minutes now. Oh, sorry. Yes, Councillor.
My voice is just a minor amendment on page 18 of the minutes in my motion to council. It wasn't my first speech. I'm glad my first speech was so long.
I wasn't
wasn't quite clear what it says. It's your first speech, but it wasn't. Okay. Right, I'm sure we can amend that just to make sure it's absolutely correct. Now, when I was signing the minutes, I'm signing
here.
Just here.
Second
second statement's from Dan Stevens in relation to item 13 on the agenda. Can I invite Dan to address the council?
Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service has suffered 50% reduction in its revenue support grant since 2010-11. This is the most severe cut of any fire and rescue service in the country. By the next financial year, the service will have lost 350 firefighter posts and 200 support service posts over that period of time. This has resulted in a loss of just short of 50% of our immediately available rescue appliances. The service has the lowest number of principal officers and middle managers in the country. Our support functions are as lean as any comparable organisation in the country. The impact on the service, as you would expect, has been significant. Any large or protracted incident presents significant challenges, not just at the incident itself, but also in maintaining emergency cover across Merseyside. Incidents elsewhere do not stop occurring when we are dealing with a major incident. On New Year's Eve and into New Year's Day, we responded to property fires, road traffic collisions, and other life risk incidents at the same time as dealing with the fire at the Liverpool Echo Arena car park. Appliances from Cheshire, Greater Manchester and Lancashire were mobilised to cover key stations across Merseyside and then mobilised on to Lancashire incidents. This simply would not have happened a decade ago. The Mayor has lobbied on our behalf alongside MPs. The City Council has previously supported motions against cuts to the Fire and Rescue Service. For that, you have our sincere gratitude. I speak on behalf of all employees of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service when I ask that you support the motion to be advanced by the Liverpool City Council Fire and Rescue Authority this evening.
Staff. That is an absolute disgrace. And then
What people don't realise is that those services that came from outside of the region to support us also had then risks themselves by depleting their service to support Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service. And that just simply can't be right. And God knows what would have happened if we had had a serious incident in Will, or Sefton, or West Derby, or anywhere within the city to contain and deal with at the same time as the car park arena fire. It just simply doesn't bear thinking about. And that's the reality of the cuts to the fire service and other emergency services, but in particular to the fire services, that I believe places the people of Merseyside region at a greater risk now than they've ever faced. And I need to say that, we need to say that, and we shouldn't leave it to our fire service personnel or to the FBE to say it, because we know that's the truth.
Which undoubtedly It was the largest of the concentration camps. What I found so shocking was not only the fact that the Nazis had built a killing machine on huge industrial scale, but the fact that I was seeing with my own eyes evidence of the most gruesome acts of inhumanity ever enacted against man. It is appropriate that this council affirms the definition of anti-Semitism, especially just days before the commemoration of Holocaust Memorial Day. It was here in Liverpool when the first HMD Day was commemorated. And Liverpool has a proud history of welcoming peoples from many different cultures and different faiths, and all underpinned by upholding the respect of the other, whatever their faith or no faith, whatever race or sexual orientation, and all coming together to build a vibrant and welcoming city. Anti-Semitism is the antithesis of respecting others, because, as Lord Sachs further suggests, hatred, which begins with the Jews, never ends with the Jews. Therefore, we must not tolerate anti-Semitism, just as we must not tolerate any other kind of prejudice in whatever form it may be, because even words can have catastrophic consequences, as we have seen in the Holocaust and other acts of genocide in Rwanda, Darfur, Cambodia, Bosnia, and other countries around the world. Every human being, no matter who, no matter what, is entitled to respect and dignity, because we are all created in the image of God. And we must not tolerate any form of hatred which abrogates human dignity. And therefore, we should not be complacent, and nor should we think that anti-Semitism or any other form of hatred does not exist. Alas, we have not yet learnt the lessons of the Holocaust, and we still hear voices which deny that the Holocaust ever took place. Therefore, I applaud and thank you all for endorsing the IHRA's definition of anti-Semitism. Thank you.
Received by Councillor Jennings. Councillor Jennings.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Can I just start by paying tribute to Sam Somoff, who died recently? Those of us on the who've suffered a half more being board or the House Select Committee will be well aware of Sam's ruthless persistence in pursuing what he sees as the right way to do things, the right way to handle the NHS. His ability to expose the fact of the creeping and blatant privatisation of the NHS ought to be applauded, and there's the hole that Sam leaves in that campaign is going to be hard to fill. I can just hope that he inspires many others to pursue the keeping NHS in public hands. And I would personally like to thank him for his persistence and patience in shining a light on what's really going on behind the scenes in the health service. Thank you, Sam. Now, I brought this amendment simply because, although the bulk of the amendment, it was agreed with the campaigners of the Health and Wellbeing Board, there's one sentence which contradicts the rest of the motion, and that's about the creation of the Liverpool Integrated Care Partnership Group. This founds itself on the creation of ACOs, the Accountable Care Organisations, which is exactly what the motion is saying that gives us a support. We had a report to the Health Select Committee which it detailed in gave quite a lot of detail about how the structure of this partnership will be working. ACOs are fundamental for that. And if we're saying that we oppose them, if we're saying we're opposing the privatisation of the NHS, we have to oppose that structure. So my motion, my amendment just simply says that we will look at an alternative way of working in partnership. We agree that partnership working is by far going to be the most efficient way, but we cannot risk exposing the new structure to privatisation. Thank you, Robert.
Can I ask that the amendment is seconded? Tom? Okay. I'll call on Captain Mayor Anderson, who wishes to respond.
Well, we reject the amendments, and we just should be referred back to the mover to read the motion. The amendment says the creation of the Liverpool Integrated Care Partnership Group has accountable systems as a key aim. What a nonsense. What an absolute nonsense. And if you'd have heard me at the Health and Wellbeing Board the way today, and if you'd have heard Councillor Kemp at the Health and Wellbeing Board, and if you'd have heard Councillor Brandt at the Health and Wellbeing Board, you couldn't have made it more clear that we are opposing the accountable care setup. We are opposing the SCP. However, what we made absolutely clear, is that we will work with SEFTA and we will work with NOSI to integrate with each other to make sure that we provide better outcomes for the people that we represent. My wife works in Pazakli Hospital as a care assistant and works with rehabilitating people who've had strokes. On occasions, there are 16 and 18 people, some of them from SEFTA, some of them from Liverpool, who can't be moved out because we don't communicate and collaborate with each other about where they go. That's exactly what we're doing. Nothing more, nothing less. Absolutely clear. But if you don't get that or you don't understand that, or you want to try and spin Sam Semoff's motives, honourable as they were, into your amendment to try and win over people, you are barking up the wrong tree. We will oppose privatisation in the health service for as long as I've got breath in my body and the people that sit on this side, because we created it. And we will oppose privatisation, and we won't be sitting silently while you try to play politics with the issue of people who are struggling to get out of hospital and into facilities that they need.
At the Health and Wellbeing Board, is that this council is in some way trying to privatise those parts of health service which are in Liverpool. And I don't believe that is the case. And in fact, this amendment is incredibly muddled. It talks here about not liking the concept of the accountable care system. Well, actually, the concept of the accountable care system is the concept of a partnership between all players. But it is not a mechanism that I think is suitable, and it's not a mechanism that this council is actually pursuing. But there can be no doubt that we need a partnership to deal with the health affairs of the people of this city and wider. Our adult care staff are performing an absolutely valiant job, in my opinion, in very difficult circumstances. They need to integrate their work with other areas because, in fact, let's take Bootle. Some people live in Bootle, Liverpool, some people live in Bootle, Sefton. It doesn't bother them. Are we saying that we will only deal with people across the border? Of course not. That's not the way we should work. That's not the way the health service should work. But there were two basic problems with the arguments put forward by the protesters, which I think the Green Party have fallen into today. They said that the mayor, this council, is trying to restrict the number of people going into hospitals. I don't think the council is doing that. I think it's trying to reduce the number of people going into hospitals. And that's absolutely right for the issue. Far too many people are going into hospital with conditions like obesity, which could and should be dealt with in the communities. So that's why I want less people to be going into hospital, because hospital is not a good place to be unless you absolutely need to be there. And then the mayor supports me when something I said to Mr. Consuth is, I want people to get out of hospital as soon as they can, because hospital isn't a good place to be. It's full of ill people, and the longer you're there, the more likely you are to get ill. Not only is that the case, but the week before our board, there was a report that came out to show just how debilitating being in hospital is. For every week that an elderly person stays in a hospital, they lose effectively a year of their life, because their musculoskeletal system gets reduced and weakened. We need people out of the hospital, walking in their communities, doing things in their communities for their mental and physical fitness. So yes, I want to get people out of hospital as quickly as possible. And I can see absolutely no wrong with that ambition. As I said before, the mayor and I don't agree on everything. But when I listened to what Paul Brandt said in his comments about what was being achieved by our social services department in partnership with others, in partnership with the health service, in trying to meet those dual needs of stopping people going in and getting people going out again, I thought that this administration was doing exactly the right things, and for that reason we will be supporting the motion and don't believe it should be mucked around with a piddling little amendment today. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I have no difficulty in understanding why individuals from outside the council might have some degree of confusion because the way in which the health service and council work together is complex and sometimes bewildering. But I'm surprised that the Green Party, in particular Councillor Jennings, who sits on the Health and Wellbeing Select Committee, who follows through this journey, are putting forward these amendments when they must fully understand, or certainly ought to fully understand, the basis of the integrated care partnership. For historic reasons, the health service and social care have grown up separately in the public sector in the UK, and the health service provides a different cohort of services than those that are provided by social care provision and public health provision. Now, both directly provided by the local authority. But the one common principle that combines the two parts of the public sector is that we are there to serve members of the public, we are there to serve the citizens of Liverpool. When you encounter an episode of ill health and you journey through the system, you will very often, particularly if you're an elderly individual, experience an aggravation of a preconditioned chronic disease that needs you then to enter into hospital to receive some treatment, which then results in you being discharged into the community where you receive community health care, receive a package of social health care, and in addition are given the additional support in terms of financial support that we as a council can wrap around in terms of your provision. Your journey through that system, those care needs and health needs need to be met, should be met in the most seamless way that you as an individual experiencing mental health should not have to navigate the complexity of the way in which the system is provided. It would be crazy if we were to make the existing complexity of the system visible to a member of the public who has to navigate it. And what's worse is that the way the system is currently being fragmented by the Tories means, first of all, that there are perverse incentives in the system, so that if you are, for example, set up as an acute trust, you have no statutory duties to anything other than the acute trust. And so your vision of success might look like pumping as many people through the hospital to maximise your revenue, when that money could perhaps be spent far more efficiently and far more effectively, keeping people well and preventing them getting ill in the first place, keeping people living independently in their own home, and preventing the deterioration of diseases that otherwise would necessitate an admission into hospital. Let me give you a specific example, therefore, of where we need to look across the ecology of social care and health to make sure that people get the best possible outcomes. And they are Entry Hospital, very recently, experienced a surge of elderly patients who had to be treated. And as a consequence, they were unable to discharge as freely as they normally would back into the community because they had a backlog of social care assessments. So because of our integrated working, the Chief Executive was able to phone up us on the council and say, we've got a problem. Will you work with us in partnership to try and deal with it? And we didn't just say, not our problem, mate, it's all yours. We accepted the joint opportunity to deal and to amend the system. So we were able to instruct some additional social workers, and we paid for them, and they attended at Entry Hospital. They facilitated and assessed those elderly people who otherwise would have been retained in hospital longer than they needed to be, got them out of hospital, got them in their own homes, got them re-abled, and made sure that they were able to live independently quicker than they would have done if we'd stood alone. Another example of where we fantastically have better outcomes for people in this city because we work closely with the health service. Our three re-ablement parts are areas where we as a council have provided the buildings, we provide the social care and assessment to enable people who are otherwise medically fit to be discharged from hospital but are unable to look after themselves adequately at home, mainly because they have deteriorating physical capacity to mobilise themselves. The health service pays for the accommodation and provides geriatrician consultants, provides physiotherapy, and provides occupational therapy. The net outcome of us working in partnership with the health service is we have people discharged from hospital when they no longer need to be there, so it's beds can be utilised by people who really need medical treatment. We have individuals who don't need to be in a hospital bed receiving cheaper treatment elsewhere because it costs less to have those individuals in one of our re-ablement hubs. We have those individuals getting the care and assistance that they need, getting the social care assessments, meaning that those individuals have better levels of capacity when they are eventually returned back to home, the lower care packages from us as our local authority, and have far fewer rates of readmission back into hospital. Lord Mayor, that is a win-win for us as a council and the health service, but far more importantly, that is a win for the residents of Liverpool. If we are not engaged in working in partnership with the health service in this city, in the way that the integrated partnership group does work in this city and will can deepen that working, then frankly, I think we should be being questioned externally to say, why aren't you working like that? It is a no-brainer. Is this, however, some form of accountable care organisation, as is suggested? Let us make it absolutely clear it is not. There is no change to any structure of accountability for any bit of the NHS or our council who are working in partnership. We are all accountable to exactly the same institutions or individuals that we were previously accountable for. Is this some form of new care organisation? Absolutely not. Every single organisation that currently provides care continues to provide that care. Is it some form of involvement of the private sector? No, it's the health service and the local authority to the clients of the public sector. Lord Mayor, I'm afraid this motion reveals nothing but a lack of understanding, a lack of knowledge, and if it was approved, we would be tearing up a vehicle for improving the people of Liverpool's lives. But it's not only working well now, it's been proved to work in the past, and if we were to tear this up now, we would frankly be betraying the duty that we all owe to the city of Liverpool. Lord Mayor, I would endorse what the Mayor has said.
Well, just to clarify the brief by position, I thought Councillor Brandt spoke very clearly, very eloquently then. I've got absolutely no doubt that his intention is to improve outcomes within Liverpool. And you know, I agree with 90% of what's in the motion. We agree with you that no more NHS should be privatised. We also want to applaud NHS workers within the city. So much to agree with, but when we take a look at the Liverpool Integrated Care Partnership, what we see is a structure which is mimicking closely the accountable care systems. And this is exactly what the government wants us to be doing, setting up these structures which are part of their process of dismantling the NHS. And so we think we have to put calls on it at some point and turn back the process of dismantling the NHS.
Well, we have two clear points of view, and so we'll put the amendment to the council. Those in favour of the amendment? Those against the amendment? Those against? Four abstentions.